Welcome to Between Two Pawns. With us today is current U.S. champion, Grandmaster Sam Shankland. Sam, welcome.
Thanks. Glad to be here.
So let's talk about the World Championship. That's topical, and then we'll get into kind of the personal stuff later. What are your thoughts on the format? Everybody wants to have an opinion about the format right now. What do you think?
Yeah, it's tough because we saw 12 draws in the classical games, which obviously is not ideal. It's easy to blame the format, but I can think the World Championship matches that I was first following when I was young with like Kramnik Anand and Kramnik Topalov and Topalov Anand. These three matches were all also 12 games and produced a lot of really exciting chess. I worry more about the development of theory as opposed to the format. I think if you have more games, I think you might just see more draws. And when we have computers as strong as they are, it's very hard to find something new in chess. This one was also an anomaly because both sides had games they could have won and failed to do so. And particularly, these players are pretty good at execution. I was a little surprised to see that. But I definitely would like to see formats change. I'm a big believer in knockout events. I always have been. I love the World Cup. I love the concept of every match producing a winner and having, I guess, let's say two-game mini matches. And I think that these, say, elite 10-player round robins, if you just turn them into 8 and 16-player knockout tournaments, I'd be roughly the same length of time, things like that. I've just been a big believer in knockout. I think that's the best way to run just about any individual sport. I would say tennis is a prime example.
Right.
I think it's the only really successful individual sport out there. And I think every tennis tournament is basically knockout. I'm not aware of any that aren't. In general, I try not to think about this stuff too much. I'm a professional chess player. It's my job to play, not to make the rules.
Right.
But my biggest recommendation would be just to have more knockout events. I think it solves a lot of problems, and it solves the draw problem because nobody's going to want to make a draw in an equal position with white if they have to come back and play a tiebreak the next day. And even if there are draws, every match produces a winner and a loser. I think knockout's a great solution.
Right. Okay, cool. So what's next for you? What's the next tournament you're playing in?
My next major event is going to be Tata Steel. It'll be my first ever chance to play with like these really top guys like Magnus, the current world champion, and play with these 2,800 players. I've never had an opportunity like that before. I've mostly been a guy who's been grinding through American Opens. I mean, that's certainly how I had the entirety of my professional development from, age 12 to, 23 or whatever. And was just all grinding through Opens in the U.S. And I'm really looking forward to finally getting a chance to play with the big boys.
Right. Awesome. So when did you become a Grandmaster?
I think it was January 2011. I mean, you can debate this stuff when I was officially awarded the title and when I fulfilled the requirements, because there's things with norms and who submits paperwork. But I think the last norm that would have counted for me to make the title was January of 2011.
Where was that game?
Actually, that was played in at Hillside School in Berkeley, which is also where I took my first chess class.
Oh, that's awesome.
So it was kind of funny
really
to come
cool.
full circle.
Why did you start playing chess?
I was good at it. I mean, I picked up the game and I was good pretty quickly. I started very late. I mean, I went to my first after school chess class when I was 9. Nowadays, all the top players are like masters at 9, and I played my first tournament at 11. So I started very late. But in general, I'm a very competitive person. And I was always a good athlete growing up, but never a great one. If there were, 60 boys in my grade, I'd probably be number 5 or 10, which is good, but you're not making any NBA drafts doing that. And when I found chess, and I was very good very quickly, it fueled my competitive need, and I just really enjoyed the game. And in general, I think human beings are predisposed to like things they're good at, and for me, chess was no exception.
Yeah. What other games do you like, do you enjoy?
I really like all kinds of sports. I like soccer. I like basketball. I'm really bad at tennis, but I like it. I'm really bad. But in general, sports that require physical fitness and strength, I do better. I'm not particularly well coordinated, so like very technical sports, I'm not as strong. But sports that require high levels of fitness and strength, like soccer, basketball, running, and the physicality, I do pretty well with those.
How much do you put emphasis on the physicalness in chess?
Oh, it's extremely important. These tournaments are, 9, 11 rounds. To play the 7th hour of your 11th game, as well as the first hour of your first game, is really important. And if you look at the way I won the U.S. Championship, for example, I won the last 3 games. I don't know how much of this had to do with me being fitter than my opponents, but I think putting a high premium on physical fitness helps a lot. And if you look at all the best players in the world, almost all of them are really fit.
I don't
think this is a coincidence.
Interesting. So what did you think about the last time you played in St. Louis, the U.S. Championship? What was your thoughts after coming out of that?
Well, obviously, it was a dream come true. I dreamt of winning the U.S. Championship for as long as I remember. I mean, I've given a lot to this country. It's the country I grew up in. It's the country I love. And I've, yeah, ever since I was a kid, I always dreamed of winning this tournament. I've played on the U.S. national team. And to finally win, it's not like it completed my career or anything. Obviously, there's a lot more I want to do, but it was the biggest milestone of my life so far, and I was just so thrilled with myself so proud of what I had done. And I mean, I looked back, I also was just, in addition to sort of the patriotism behind it, I was also very, very happy that I played, I think, really good chess.
Yes, definitely.
Undoubtedly, I got lucky to some extent. You can never win a tournament that strong with the score I accomplished without getting somewhat lucky, but I think I really played well as well, and that really made me happy.
So where do you see yourself after the professional chess playing is over? What do you eventually see yourself doing?
I would want to do something completely different. A lot of that depends to some extent how good you get at chess, because if you make it absolutely to the top and make a ton of money, you can do whatever you want.
Right.
I mean, if I were, let's say, like, if you were to take like a perfect world for me, now obviously this is a very ambitious goal and very unlikely to happen, but let's say I win the world championship once when I'm like 31, defend it at 33, lose it at 35. Like, this would be like a perfect career for me that obviously is, you know, I think that's kind of everyone's dream and almost never comes true. But suppose that were to happen, I would say by 40, I'm climbing Kilimanjaro.
Right.
Just like going out seeing the world.
Awesome.
I really like nature. I like doing physical things like that. But assuming that following my chess career, I'd still have to be working for money and stuff like that, I'd probably try to stay somewhat involved with the chess world, teaching kids and trying to raise the next generation of young American players.
And you're in California right now, right?
Yeah, I live in Walnut Creek.
And do you love that? Is that where your home?
Yeah, I mean, I grew up maybe 20 minutes away from where I'm currently living. I really like Walnut Creek. It's a great city. It's where a lot of the athletes in the Bay Area live from, like, the more physical sports. Like, a lot of the Warriors live there and some others. It's great. It's very healthy living. It's very flat.
Yeah.
It's very sunny. But also, it's close to home. And for someone who travels as much as I do, you really want that sense of feeling at home
definitely.
When you're not traveling. So I'm glad I live there.
Good. So you said you wrote a book. It just came out recently, right?
I did. Small Steps to Giant Improvement, Master Pawn Play in Chess. That came out this year in March.
Right.
So it's, you know.
How was that process of writing it?
It was definitely a different experience for me. I definitely learned some things about it, but I just sort of wanted to get it done. It only took me a little over a month to write, but when I say that, I mean, my alarm was going off at 7:30 every morning, and by 8:15 a.m. I was writing, and I was writing all day. So it didn't take that long in terms of, like, the length of the year, but in the terms of sheer hours, it took a fair amount of work.
Right.
And I'm just very glad that it's been so well received. I think winning the U.S. championship and having such a good results afterwards was definitely a good promotion for the book, and it helped sales a lot. But yeah, no, but I think anybody, unless you're like J.K. Rowling or someone, you're not writing a book to get rich. You're writing a book because you want to get your message
out.
And you want people to read what you have to say and enjoy it. And I'm glad that it's been selling so well.
Yeah. So what's your favorite pawn?
Gotta be the D pawn.
The D pawn, nice.
I mean, I don't know, D4 through and through. I play every move with white, but I don't know. I guess I like the D pawn.
You know, one of the comments that we got was that people wanted to know, how have your openings changed since when you first started playing to what you're doing now and then your thought process behind them? Don't get too technical with it, but just kind of overall.
Right. Well, first of all, I learned to actually play openings. Even when I was almost a grandmaster, I just didn't have any preparation. So actually having done some work, definitely changed my repertoire a lot. I gave up lines that were just bad, and like, even if someone told me a line, I was very stubborn growing up, and if someone told me a line was bad and I didn't understand why, I would just not believe them, even if they were a much better player and they were right. So once I actually started studying and figured out why some lines were bad, I'd stop playing them, and I certainly tried to play a wide range of openings, because I think you really need to play a wide range of different kinds of middle games and different kinds of positions to be a good chess player, because chess is not like soccer, where if you suck at stopping the ball with your hands but you're good at kicking with your feet, just don't be a goalie.
Right.
In chess, you have to play every position that comes in front of you, and playing a wide range of different kinds of structures and middle games I think was very helpful for me.
Are there any more TV plans? You were on Kicking and Screaming.
I mean, I'd love to go back to the jungle, but I think Kicking and Screaming got canceled, so that's certainly not coming back. But I mean, if the casting company wants to recruit me again, I'm certainly very open to it. So call casting companies, I'm ready. But
that's awesome.
I don't really want to go through the process of like applying normally. I got in Kicking and Screaming because I was just recruited.
Yeah, yeah.
But I haven't been recruited for anything since.
So right, right. What do you think that there's something that you know the chess world can do to get it more popular and get people to engage more on through TV or through YouTube, whatnot? What do you think what's not happening?
I think, first of all, the game needs to be more exciting, but I also think people need to take it more professionally. And I don't want to call any specific person out by name, because I think a lot of professional players do this, and it's not out of malice, but people are showing up late to games, they're showing up dressed inappropriately, things like that. And I just think about like the successful sports like soccer and basketball. I'm like, can you imagine like a soccer player just like, oh, sorry, you know, 10 minutes after kickoff, sorry, I'm late, like, wait up for me. I mean, this kind of behavior, I think, is entirely unacceptable. And again, I don't mean to single anyone out.
Right.
I don't think there's any specific person that's doing this more than others that needs to be punished or weeded out of the game. And I don't think you should blame people for doing that when it's sort of part of our culture that it's acceptable. But I think that culture absolutely needs to change.
Yeah.
So I think that's a big one. Learning to respect ourselves is the first step towards making the mainstream respect us. And,
right.
And I think we need to make more outreach and see chess more popular in schools. I think what you guys are doing here in St. Louis is great. If I'm not mistaken, you guys have chess in every single public school in St. Louis.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, that's a huge accomplishment that I think you guys should be very proud of. And you guys are clearly leading the way in terms of doing this. I'd love to see that happen all over the country.
Yes, that would be cool.
Obviously, any individual only has so much power
to do these
kind of things. But you know, I certainly try to do my part to make it popular in California. I was teaching an after-school class at the middle school there.
It definitely feels like it needs to come from the bottom up as opposed to the top down at this point. Like
it
needs to feel like it's organic. And
yeah, I mean, it's hard to force this kind of thing, but I think kids are really interested in chess when you introduce it to them and encourage them the right way. And I think it can teach a lot of other skills. I mean, most kids who take chess classes don't become pro players, but they still find it very rewarding and learn a lot.
Yes, and can excel at other things, yeah.
Yes, absolutely.
Awesome. All right, well, thank you very much for joining us, and we will talk to you later.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks for being here.
Thanks.